Chair, the situation, yes, with regards to those who listened to the call of His Excellency, we've had 46 who came back. And these 46, if they were dismissed, they are no longer dismissed. They are now reinstated. And the process was that they would present themselves, their place of work, original place of work, and then to sign the assumption of duty form. It's just a signature, you know, because they were not at work all the time, and therefore an assumption of duty has to be filled in order to record that someone has come back to work. That's the only way you can be able to be back on the records and to be placed, you know, under the SSB patient. You know, so assumption of duty forms is a necessity, was a necessity in order to be able to reinstate someone to their original position. So that is what has happened. You know, in total, out of the 448, so 46 have come back, you know, leaving that outstanding balance of 402. For some reason, if some of those doctors had not presented, you know, and if they got a good case as to why they hadn't been able to present themselves by yesterday at 8:30, that will be looked at. The Cabinet wants the doctors back at work. Cabinet does not want to see any more suffering of the patients. Cabinet does not want to see people dying, and that is why His Excellency presented that moratorium. You know, and the situation is that, according to Cabinet, discussions and requests, you know, for improving remuneration, conditions of service, should be ongoing while people are at work. And that is precisely what that moratorium was awarded by His Excellency. You know, so that, you know, people are at work and discussion can be held. Cabinet can therefore be able to be discussing with people who are at work rather than people who are not at work. So, as the chairperson has indicated, the cabinet, you know, has directed that, you know, there be discussions with those who are at work. You know, so that is what the status quo is, as the situation is. Yes, you're quite right. Government has tried all it can. Government has, from the very top of government, given that moratorium for people to come back. Yes, you know, it has been a situation where negotiations have to carry on, you know, and but the goodwill from the doctors should also have been that the His Excellency has extended that moratorium period. Let's go back to work and be able to negotiate, you know, while we are at work, as has been indicated by His Excellency and Cabinet. That moratorium, you know, was a very good sign. That was a sign of fatherhood, you know, on the part of the President, and he showed that fatherhood. And he showed the nation that he wants, you know, his doctor to come back to work. And we should just respect that. And so, like I said, if there's any doctors who might not have been able to come because of extenuating circumstances, you know, they can always put it in writing, but the situation is as is. The moratorium is not extended. So what will government do next? You know, government will go back to the status quo, which is where we had been given the opportunity by the moratorium. The status quo was that all doctors that were not at work, I want to repeat that very clearly, all doctors that were not at work would have to follow the labor court ruling. That is what the status quo was. All doctors that were not at work and had not presented themselves within the 48 hours, you know, would have to go through the disciplinary action. And the disciplinary action yielded dismissals as the outcome. And then there's also the other 57 senior doctors who were allowed, you know, to carry on at work without any hassles, you know, so they should also be taking advantage of that situation and be back at work. You know, so it leaves the 402 doctors who have been dismissed. It means that we're going back to that status quo, because the moratorium has passed. The period has now passed. And however, you know, as I indicated, government will continue negotiating with those doctors who are at work. Once we've come back to work, government will continue discussing and intermediate discussion with them. You know, and that is what the status quo, and that is what government will do next. I hope I've made it clear. And I want to re-emphasize again, we've always been very appreciative of all those senior doctors, you know, who were providing emergency work, you know, and we will continue appreciating all the doctors right through the country who have been providing service, saving lives, including those doctors working at the mission hospitals. We are very appreciative of the work that they are doing. So it's now a situation where government will, as it has always indicated, will negotiate with those doctors who are at work and listen to them. I would have been very happy, well, we would have been very happy, you know, if those doctors who are living within the institutional residences would have come to work. The incapacitation in terms of transport, they are in government accommodation, and at the hospital accommodation, at the institutional accommodation. You know, so if there was something amiss which made them unavailable to be able to report for duty, I think, you know, there would have to be a reason for an extenuating circumstance as to why they would want to be considered. I think the moratorium was a very useful moratorium, because it cancelled the whole issue of applying for the jobs and should have been taken advantage of. The other pending disciplinary issues, as I indicated, you know, the only major disciplinary issues which were pending were those relating to the senior doctors. The senior doctors had not been fired by the Health Services Board. They had merely been invited for hearings, and that, you know, was also put to rest. You know, so they are in the clear. You know, so we have a situation where we have to go back to the status quo in terms of the law. It's always the law, you know, but we have got this moratorium which has helped everyone. You know, so. My final statement is that government, cabinet, wants the doctors back at work, and that is why the president went all the way and awarded the moratorium. And therefore, it is now up to the doctors to do what they have to do for those who have been dismissed. If they don't have any extenuating circumstances, it means that they have to apply, you know, to come back to work. You know, that's the law. We're just following the law. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister Obidaya Moyo. I think it's clear.
The National Housing and Social Amenities is with a very clear and specific mandate. The mandate is to provide functional human settlement, which speaks to Vision 2030. We have separated the mandate into segments. The first segment is the construction of institutional accommodation. Institutional accommodation for health workers and doctors. Institutional accommodation for teachers and other civil servants. Because of the nature of the health services environment, we have decided to give that a priority number one. So as of yesterday, we started embarking on the construction of institutional accommodation for health workers and doctors and nurses. We started with five hospitals. Parenyatwa being number one, we're going to be constructing brand new blocks of flats, five stories and four stories, middle income blocks of flats at Parenyatwa Hospital. We also, at the same time, go to SlyMedia, formerly Harare Hospital, construct two blocks of similar nature as well. We go to Blawayo, Mpilo Hospital, and the United Blawayo Hospitals. That is the phase one of the construction program. The phase two will target all the provincial general hospitals. Then we then move to district hospitals. So there's going to be a massive uplift of the phases of our hospitals in terms of accommodation. For our staff, we have decided to construct within the cantonment of the hospitals to ease the effects of transport, to ease the cost of transport for the junior doctors, for the nurses, and for all other health services employees. We, as providers of shelter, and we're all aware that shelter is not just a policy, but it is enshrined in the constitution. It's a human right. We are going to look at the urban areas in terms of facelifting, speaking to Vision 2030, we move to peri-urban areas, we move to resettlement areas, we also move to rural areas. We are developing a concept of which we want to be, by Vision, by 2030, we have human settlements in the rural areas without pit latrines, without wells, but with running water, septic tanks and soak away. That's what we're focusing on. We do the same with resettlement areas. Coming to urban areas, we have an issue with illegal settlements. I think it's important that we discuss it. Illegal settlements are a thing of the past. We are not going to be demolishing people's houses. That is not the agenda. We are going to be regularizing those that are in existence. Of course, in the regularization process, there are those that will stand in the way of a road. There are those that will stand in the way of water and sewer articulation systems. Those who obviously have to go. But we will provide alternative accommodation for those that will be affected. So in a nutshell, Honorable Chair, that is the agenda from the Minister of National Housing and Social Amenities.
That is the efforts which are...
Thank you very much, ABC, for that question. That is what has been said, but I also want to indicate that at the time when we were talking, you know, with the doctors, at the time when we were discussing, we've categorized the issues that can be done immediately. And the issues that can be taken care of immediately by government include, number one, the issue of transport, provision of transport. Number two, the issue of accommodation outside the institutions. Those are immediate because we have already identified some flats which are going to be renovated, you know, make them comfortable, you know, for the doctors to be able to occupy them. And at the same time, we've also talked about giving them fuel. You know, we've said, you know, we'll be able to work out, you know, a fuel budget, you know, so that we can be able to give all our healthcare workers fuel at the institutions where they work. Especially at the central hospitals, they already got petrol so facilities, you know, facilities, you know, for providing fuel. And we've said that, you know, we're going to be improving the accommodation which currently exists at the institutions, you know, and also make it cozy and comfortable for someone who will be working for long hours, you know, lounges, you know, where they can also spend some time with Wi-Fi, everything being made available. We've already made all those arrangements, you know. So the issue of medicines, like I indicated before, those are issues where we have been on a continuous, on a weekly basis, you know, accumulating, you know, the amount of medicines, you know, in our institutions. You know, so the medicines are coming through. If they were to go back to work, you know, they would have, you know, some medicines available, you know, syringes, surgical supplies. You know, we've also gone to tender, you know, for all this. These are the surgical and medicines. You know, these have matured, and within a very short space of time, we should be able to receive, you know, these products. Equipment will take a bit longer, you know, for us to have it, and they also acknowledge the same, that it cannot just happen overnight. Number one, we have to identify the foreign currency. Number two, we have to get the consultants themselves, you know, to identify the pieces and approve, you know, that they are the correct paraphernalia, you know, for their use. You know, so that is the situation. That is really the situation. I don't know if that's satisfactory, right? Thank you very much for agreeing with me.
Thanks, Minister.